Hey guys, Hattie Drago here. God, am I tired. So, you probably noticed, if you're watching this the day that this is uploaded, you'll also notice that I uploaded two other videos that are Yu-Gi-Oh! Related that I wasn't actually planning on doing today, but because I didn't want to forget about them, I did it today. But for the Yu-Gi-Oh!, my Facebook group, we're doing a character deck tournament where we're all making character decks for Yu-Gi-Oh! And having a tournament. So if you want to check that out, go ahead and check that out. I'll leave a link in the description, I suppose, to the playlist. There's only two videos out right now as of this video being recorded. But there's going to be a big old tournament, like whole tournament. And you're going to see my awesome Chaz deck, if you know who Chaz is. Chaz Monjomi. Oh, pardon, sorry. Or no, it's Chaz Princeton. Right. Anyways, so I promised that I would make a magic video dedicated to talking about Oath of the Gatewatch. And actually, I said before that I would make two. One just talking about cards that I like that stand out, and one talking about limited like I did last time. But I honestly don't have the time to do that, and I still have to... Me and some of my group members for Yu-Gi-Oh! Still want to do a discussion for Breakers of Shadow? Is that what it's called? The next Yu-Gi-Oh! Set coming out next week. So, I'm going to talk about Limited as well as talk about cards for Oath of the Gatewatch. This is really, really casual. I'm recording this on my Mac, even though my PC so far has been doing way better with almost everything. I will be uploading it with the PC, though. PC will be my YouTube business laptop. And my Mac will be my Mac, my YouTube leisure laptop. So, anywho. Let's get started with this. So, colorless first. I do enjoy everything from Oath of the Gatewatch. It's all kind of weird and complex. The way I'm going to do this, I'm going to go over all the rares, either rares and mythics for sure. Not sure how thoroughly, like I might keep it really brief depending on the card. And uncommons, if there's a really good uncommon, I'll check it out. Actually, I should get my phone out. I'm going to make sure to pay attention to the stock prices as well, because... Like, wherever the money's going is where everyone's hype is going. Of course, I will have a different opinion on where everyone's hype is compared to what the stock market's going. When I say stock market, I'm talking about MTG Goldfish. It's my preferred source of Magic the Gathering prices. This isn't a sponsor. It's not. This isn't anything to do with, like, they sponsor me or anything. They don't. This is just my preference. Oh yeah, looks like they're all updated. Sweet. Actually, no, they're not. So I'll go through as many as I can in regards to what they have on here. So, anywho. The first two rares, there's two, first we're going through colorless, and the first card we're looking at, Deceiver of Form, actually uses, you can see my mouse, yeah you can, this symbol right here. If you're not aware, if you've been under a rock for the past few weeks, this is like a new way that they're determining colorless mana. And colorless mana will always have this symbol now, and then whenever there's a number in something's cost, that's generic mana, which is actually really good for clarifying for newer players. And also, it's another good way to make the Eldrazi seem really weird and such. Because, I mean, after the Zendikar block cycles out, the colorless mana symbol is not going to be on cards, generally, at all. Until, you know, whenever Eldrazi pop up, this colorless mana symbol will be back. But for most sets, it's not going to be an issue. So, this is probably the only set in a long time that we're actually and for like a few years, that this mana symbol will actually be in the cost of cards. But for like lands, this is going to be the symbol forever. And ever. And ever. And I totally called it. I called it months ago that they would make this basic land. I'll get to it. So Deceiver of Form, it's a 7-drop 8/8, which is pretty cool. Beginning of combat on your turn, reveal the top card of your library. If creature cards revealed, you may have creatures you control other than this one become copies of the card that you just revealed. And then you can put the card on top or bottom of your deck. So, worst case scenario, this is letting you scry one, although it's a revealed scry. Best case scenario, you're going to be attacking with a lot of things. And it's not even requiring this card to attack. It's just requiring it to be on the field. So that's nice. I wonder what happens if this card's revealed off the top with this effect. I'm sure we'll get it in the release notes, what the interaction is. If there is an interaction, it could be just like beginning of combat's over after this effect goes off. It won't go off again. Who knows? It sounds crazy, though. Will this see standard play? I personally don't think so. It's interesting. It could. Someone could make it interesting. But the problem with standard right now is that everything that's expensive and good is expensive and good already. And I don't think they need this. The Abzans and the expert controls. If this pops up anywhere, it'll be in some kind of interesting brew that someone makes up. Modern? Heck no. I don't think so, anyways. I'm also going to be on the side. I got on my other computer. I got Mythic Pro. Sorry. Yu-Gi-Oh. Mythic spoiler up. Just to look at, see what the internet says. Because I do enjoy what the internet says. Yeah, no one thinks it's going to be standard or constructed playable. It's going to be really good and limited, though. I tell you what. So, to a actually somewhat better card is Eldrazi Mimic. It's a 2-drop, 2/1 Eldrazi. Whenever another colorless creature enters the battlefield, Eldrazi power toughness becomes the colorless creature's power and toughness. That includes artifacts. So, that'll be fun. I don't know. I wonder if this is being talked anywhere. I don't think so. I don't know if it's that good. But it seems really fun. It seems like something that someone will try and make good in standard. But it's also something that is just interesting with interactions with fun creatures like Phyrexian Dreadnought, that people have been talking about. I think it's interesting. I don't know if it's constructed ready. I think it's more constructed ready than Deceiver Reform, anyways. Oh god, more powerhouses. Endbringer is another colorless creature using the colorless mana symbol, and it's having a lot of fun. I actually enjoy this card quite a bit. A 6 mana for a 5/5 is okay, but the fact it untaps during each other player's untap step, it has 3 different tap abilities that you pay different mana costs for, all colorless. You just tap them, deal 1 damage, tap with the mana, with the colorless mana. Target creature, can't attack or block this turn. 2 colorless and tap, draw a card. I think it's interesting. I don't think it's good. Enough. Well, no, let me rephrase this. It may be good enough for whatever Eldrazi decks exist right now, but I don't think it's good enough to be like a highly valued card in those decks. I mean, it's interesting. It's a bomb in limited. For limited play, you play this. Also, actually, I should mention this. Deceiver of Form, limited play, use it. Use it and not will be awesome. Bombs are bombs. Bombs are amazing. But with Endbringer, it's an okay card. It's good. Just, it's not something to be really get overhyped about. The can't attack or block thing is good. It can save your whatever's on the field. And there's so many better ways to draw a card in this format. I'm not 100% sold on using colorless mana for drawing a card. And actually, speaking of the colorless mana for drawing a card, when we get to the lands, I'll talk about what MTG Goldfish had a really good article the other day about the lands, because the lands were all revealed before the rest of the cards, so they had a chance to talk about them all. Thought it was really good. So now to a card that will definitely see play in one way, shape, or form. It's Kozilek, the Great Distortion. It costs 10 mana for 12/12. 8 colorless, or sorry, 8 generic mana and 2 colorless. And when you cast Kozilek, and if you have fewer than 7 cards, you draw cards equal to the difference. So you draw up to 7, essentially. Then it's got Menace, which is okay. And then you discard a card with converted mana cost X, you counter target spell converted mana cost X. This is a really weird one. And it's definitely not better than Ulamog. Ulamog's better than Kozilek and definitely better than this. I mean, just comparing their effects side by side, I think the only thing that's better about Kozilek, really, is the power and toughness, because Ulamog's, what, a 10-10? Need to actually look at that real quick, because it's been a while since I've looked at the damn card. Click. No. I need to click on this. Thanks. Yeah, Ulamog's a 10-10 for 10. So even their mana costs are kind of the same, except Kozilek is a tad bit more difficult because of the colorless mana symbols. The first effect, Ulamog's, is so much better. Exiling 2 permanents is a bit better than drawing cards, but the drawing cards is a good thing. The Menace, I guess it's fine. It depends on what you're going up against, really. Like, yeah, Menace is definitely helping you get rid of their creatures more if they have a creature-heavy board, but that's not going to be your games all the time. That's actually more of a win-more type of thing than it is Ulamog, who's indestructible, actually protects him from getting off the field. Go away. Oh, no, I actually need my phone. Oh yeah, price-wise, I keep forgetting to check on that for you guys. But with the last point with Kozilek versus Ulamog, the discard a card to counter things, I mean, that's cool. But Ulamog's attacking and exiling 20 cards off the player's library, that's insane. That's just over and abound more brutal than this. But in truth, this will see constructed play. I'm not sure how much before rotation. But Eldrazi decks do exist. They'll continue to exist. And they'll continue. And now they have more support to be able to be interesting and semi-good. But they'll use both Ulamog and Kozilek. Kozilek will be good for keeping your advantage up. And then Ulamog will be great for finishing them off. Let's look at the prices on some of these, shall we? The Kozilek's going for 15, 16 bucks. That's about right. I honestly don't see it going much higher unless Eldrazi really become a thing. And comparison, Ulamog's 20 bucks, which 20, 21 bucks, which is perfect. that Ulamog costs more than Kozilek, because... And it's kind of unfortunate, because Kozilek's supposed to be more powerful than Ulamog is in the lore. Deceiver form, I'm going to guess, like, a buck rare. Yep. And the Mimic is also a buck rare. The Endbringer is also a buck rare. So, I think my assumptions are correct that these cards, the first three, aren't really going to see play at all. Kozilek definitely will. I'm not going to... I'll breeze over commons, but this common for limited 6-drop 5/5 is decent. And pay mana to have creatures not block it. It's pretty good. Play it. Play it in limited. You'll be happy. Matter Reshaper. Now, this is a card that people are talking about. Oh god, it's not even up on Goldfish yet. I guess I need to open up TCG Player somewhere. But no, people are talking about this card a lot. Sorry. People are talking about this card for Standard for sure. Its stats are decent enough. And it fits right in with the Collected Company decks. Now, I don't know how big of a deal this card will be in Standard. I honestly don't think it's going to be that big of a deal. But it's a good card, nonetheless. Hold up. Okie doke. Actually, I should just be searching through these by name. Sorry. Alright, so. So, Matter Reshaper on TCG is currently going for $8. That seems a little overhyped for me. It is good. And it will see play in some way, shape, or form. I don't think it will see enough play pre-rotation to do a lot. Not to say it won't do anything. But I think $8 is a little much. I think it will go down. Definitely probably is going to go down. Maybe $4. Maybe even lower. And then maybe it will come back up when Cons and Fate Reforged rotate. Because colorless decks are going to be a little bit more fun to use when rotation happens. I might actually try to get Matter Reshaper for my Commander deck, because that's what I'm playing currently. Standard is definitely not in my budget range. I'm so sorry that I can't talk about Standard so much, but I'll probably get back into Standard once rotation happens and the fetch lands are gone and everything's cheaper. And then Mono Red won't be expensive. It's not supposed to be expensive. Alright, Reality Smasher. This guy is interesting. This guy looks fun. This guy is $5. And I don't think it's going to stay there. But it's a 5-drop 5/5, which is already passes kind of the vanilla test. Got Trample and Haste, which are both great. And then whenever it becomes the target of a spell, counter that spell unless its controller discards a card. Now, it is pretty cool. Target of a spell your opponent controls, so that's good, since, I forgot to talk about Matter Reshaper and Limited. It's fine, play it, it's whatever. But Reality Smasher, play in Limited, and you will love life. This card is going to be so much fun in Limited. Trample and Haste, 5/5, just hits forever. And opponent targets it with anything, they have to discard a card or it gets countered. That's just a lot of fun. I actually can't wait to use this card. If I use this card in Limited, I'm going to have so much fun with it. It's really not. And, I mean, its price is being hyped. It may be used in the Eldrazi decks. I think it's a well-costed and good effect enough to be used in some of the Eldrazi decks that are out there. But if it ends up not working as well, wait, maybe I'm reading the price wrong. Nope, I'm reading it correctly. I think the price will go down a little bit if... Well, I mean, most of these prices are going to go down because we're in pre-release hype mode. But I think this guy will go down a good bit if he's not used effectively enough. If it's proven that he's actually not that good, even though he's pretty decent. So, let's see. And then maybe once rotation happens, he'll be a little better. We'll shall see. Now, spatial contortion, an uncommon worth note. It's a buck uncommon, so it's definitely worth talking about a little bit. For limited, you're going to love this card. It's going to be able to be played in any deck. It's essentially either removal or win more. And that's it. It's just really fun like that. And I do not think it's going to see play in Constructed. There's just nowhere it will go. Like, most... I'd have to look at all the stats of the Eldrazi aggro decks or any aggro deck, but I don't think it's going to work. But Limited, pick it. You'll love it. Thought Not Seer. I Thought Not. It's also $4. Three generic, one colorless, enters battlefield, target opponent reveals his or hand. You choose a non-land card from it and exile it. And when it leaves play, target opponent draws a card. So, it's a 4-drop, 4-4 that murks something from the opponent's hand and never gives it back, which is actually really cool. And then when it leaves, your opponent draws a card. Yeah, I kind of think this one's being a little overhyped. I don't think this card is good enough. Well, I mean, comparing it side by side between the Thought Not and the Walker of the Waste, the Thought Not is definitely better. I'm just not sure how good it is. Oh, limited for sure, but constructed, it's up in the air for me. Now, Walker of the Waste, I think, is pretty interesting. It's really going towards the wanting to use wastes, which are the new basic lands, the colorless basic lands. Sorry. Stiffy nose. And, you know, you just want the nom nom on all the lands. All the wastes, the nom nom nom. This will be interesting, actually. This is the one card that I think is going to make Limited the most interesting at pre-releases. Because generally, when you're building decks for pre-releases, you know, all the basic lands are provided for you most of the time at your locals. But I'm wondering what card shops are going to have to do because of the wastes. Because, I mean, we've had plains, islands, swamp, forests, and mountains forever since the game began. But wastes is literally just from this set. And if anyone needs more wastes in their decks, they're going to have to search. They're going to have to go to other tables, probably, and be like, hey, are you using your wastes? Can I use them? From whatever packs people have drawn. Or stores will have to open product to be able to get these wastes and get them in there. And the fat packs aren't going to even be out yet on pre-release, so that's interesting. Well, I mean, I'm sure after pre-release, when fat packs are actually available, wastes will be more abundant for drafts. But for pre-release, I think this will be an interesting issue, and I'll definitely be paying attention to what happens when it happens. But as is, a 5-drop 4-4 that gains +1/+1 for each waste. It's fine. It's not the best. It's fine. Warden of Geometries, Common, Vigilance, taps mana. It's pretty good. Pretty cool. It's not much else to say. Warping Whale. Now, this is fun. This is actually being talked about for modern play, funny enough. Because the exile target... Like, all of these abilities are relevant. Well, the colorless Eldrazi Scion is a little less relevant unless it's a Eldrazi deck. And actually, looking at the... actually, there's no prices on it at the moment. It's probably a cheap one, though. Oh, wow. Actually, TCG Player has it at $2. Okay, yeah. That's, like I said, it's being hyped. For good reason. The first ability exiles a lot of annoying creatures that are used in modern, like, Young Pyromancer, Snapcaster Mage, a few other cards. Oh my god, I forgot his name. Bug. The bug before he becomes a bug. I can't believe I forgot his name. But it exiles him before he becomes a 2/3 flyer. Or no, it's 3/2 flyer. God damn it, what? I'm so sad I forgot his name. Anyways, and the countering of sorcery is actually really good as well. Because a lot of cards in a lot of strategies in modern do require using a sorcery spell for their combos. So this would definitely be like a sideboard card in some modern decks. I could see it. Everyone's seeing that it could happen. And now for my least favorite card in this entire set. Currently my least favorite. It's not because it's bad. It's not because it's good. It's because I don't understand why it's white. The reason I say this, as it's a $6-7 card currently. It's white, and I need to look up if there is an article about this guy, because I haven't seen if there's an article talking about this particular card and why he's white. But last set, there was a whole design panel saying that, Eldrazi are the least, white is the color that the Eldrazi are least like. So I'm wondering why they chose for a card to be white. It's understandable from an aspect of the Eldrazi absorb mana, they have all the mana, but they're also colorless and blah blah blah. But they said that there wouldn't be white Eldrazi, or they're right, I don't know. It's confusing. I hope there's an article talking about it that I'm just not aware of. If there is, and you know, can you please post it so I can go read it? It'd be great. So, the card itself. 3/3/3, devoid. Exile another target creature, then return it to the battlefield tapped under its own control. So this is a good way. This is definitely great in limited. This is amazing in limited. Play it always. It's a good way to get rid of creatures that are attacking you, like remove them from combat. It's a great way to blink something on your turn, or that you own, so that it gets an effect. There's so many ways you can play this effect. I personally think it's overhyped at $6-7. I don't know if it's gonna find an immediate home somewhere, unless it may be in an Eldrazi deck. I don't know. We'll see. 3/1/4 Vigilance, it's fine. And it's an ally, it's fine. Allied Reinforcements, 4-drop Sorcery, 2/2/2 White Knight Allies, Creature Tokens. It's fine. It's okay. It's not worth really talking about. Now, what's kind of worth talking about is the whole Planeswalker Matters strategy that's within this format. Actually, it's a good thing that they made all of the Planeswalker Matter cards rare or above. Mainly rare. Because otherwise, it would be unplayable and limited. As of now, all of the rares are probably never gonna... Well, no, the Oaths will be played for their first effects, at least. But essentially, all the Planeswalker Matters cards aren't that playable in limited, unless you're able to draft around it correctly. Like, if you open up a pack and you get that Planeswalker, and you're like, oh my god, this is amazing, you can go ahead and, if you find any of the other Planeswalker Matters cards, you can play them. But even then, Call of the Gatewatch isn't good for limited, But if you're wanting to make super friends, Merry Christmas. There you go. It's still not the best. Like, the argument is, you'd rather have that this card be a planeswalker rather than this card going to search for a planeswalker. But, it's fine. It's okay. Now, before we get to this card, this card's okay. It's gain life equal to target creature's power, which is cool. Next time that creature would deal damage, this turn prevent that damage. In limited, this is great. Definitely for the life gain strategy, that is so good. I love the limited life gain strategy. The white, black, white, light game, life game. And essentially this is you target your opponent's Eldrazi, gain a bunch of life, Merry Christmas Land. But look at this art. This art is dope. I love this art. It's a Felidar with its horns glowing. I love it. Just one of the best arts, in my opinion. Alright, Expedition Raptor. This is the first time we're seeing support so far. Support, it's a mechanic. Put a +1/+1 counter on each of up to two other target creatures. This card kind of reminds me of... There was a card in one of the limited sets. No, it was either one of the limited sets or it was in Khan's block. I can't remember. I think it was Dragons, actually. But essentially, it was some cranes that were 5-drop something-something. And when they entered play, they could give out token. Oh, sorry, +1/+1 counters. Now, the comparison between this bird and the cranes from last time, that the cranes could put the +1/+1 counters on himself if he needed to. But the downside of support is not much of a downside because this strategy is going to be using a lot of creatures anyway. But the downside of this mechanic, compared to those cranes, and compared to bolster, is that you can't put it on yourself. You can't put it on your own card. Like, the Raptor enters play, if there's nothing else on board, the support 2 is useless, and you just paid 5 for a 2/2 flyer. And that's really bad. So, this is an interesting... The mechanic's great. I enjoy the mechanic. But this card in particular is really weird because it's going to be bad if you play it with nothing on the field. Just so forewarning all of you, don't play this card unless you really need to if you have nothing, no creatures on the board. It's not a good idea. Alright, General Tazri, first legendary creature other than Kozilek. And we know how much we love Kozilek. General Tazri, I'm not going to go through her whole effect. Essentially, she is the Commander Lord. She's actually from the lore stories. She's actually really kind of a bitch in the lore. I'm sure she's going to redeem herself now. And where are you price-wise? You're a mythic, right. $3. Sorry. I've never had a stuffy nose lately. Yeah. Whatever. Anyways, ETB, get an ally, and then you pay 5 mana, one of each color, besides colorless, of course. You control all creatures, ally creatures, get +X, where X is the number of colors among those creatures. So, it doesn't count Eldrazi, the colorless mana, because that's not a color. It means they have no color. So at most, you're paying 5 to pump +5/+5. But on the other opposite coin, you could be paying 5 for +1/+1. Or +0/+0. And that sounds really... Well, no, it's always going to be +1/+1 because of her color. But... She's definitely a draft around me type of card for limited. I'm not 100% sure how well she's going to function, but it's okay. Now, a card that's great is Emulating Great. Emulating Glare. And actually, I believe... Actually, it's only 50 cents. It's not that hyped. Jeez. So, for two, for a colorless and white, instant, destroy a target attacking creature. This is amazing. If you're drafting and your rare is crap, you pick this card. Unless you got another uncommon that is interesting. I mean beginning of the game. But this card's really good for draft, for limited. Might see standard play, maybe, but it's not going to go anywhere else. So have fun with that. Iona's Blessing. An enchantment aura, +2/+2, vigilance, can block an additional creature. It's okay. It would be fun to put this on an Eldrazi and laugh, like a big giant Eldrazi and laugh. But, not much of a point of this card. It's okay. It's a halfway decent enchantment that helps and stuff. And it references Iona, so we know Iona's still alive, I think. Next, Isolation Zone. It's essentially an overcosted, really specific Journey to Nowhere. Not much else to say. Limited, it will probably be fine, because they can target giant Eldrazi and get them out your way. But otherwise, it's not the best. Core Scythe Master, 3-drop, 3-1, first strike while attacking. It's not bad. It's definitely one of those cards for beginning players to let them know that to win, you gotta turn your thing sideways. Just sideways. That's all I can really say. There's one thing that I have to point out, though, about all of these cores. So these cores are now they're allies. Like, all of them are allies for the most part, that I'm not going to go through the past ones. But even the ones that fly, like this one, it flies, and it's an ally. So they're no longer going to be a joke of none of the core allies that fly are allies at all. It's weird. Speaking of cores that fly, 3-drop, 3-2, if you pay 2, she gains flying. It's not bad. It's okay. You know, it's limited fun time. Well, you know what's limited fun time and constructed fun time is Linvala the Preserver. People are talking about this being like the second coming of Thraktus. It kind of is. It kind of isn't. Both of these effects are... have to have go through some kind of condition. This is definitely going to be interesting in control. Which I think that's generally where its home is going to be, is in some control decks. Maybe mid-range. But I generally enjoy this card. Like, I think price-wise is one of the big ones. And it's going to see play. No, it's $9. So it's at a decent price. It's definitely going to be tried out. If it sees a lot of play, is left to be seen. Oh, sorry. But you know, next set is Shadows over Innistrad, and there might be more support for Angels in that set. There may actually be an Angels Matter format. Who knows? Maybe Linvala will be really good in rotation when Angels matter. If they matter. I'm so sorry for coughing and such. I think I'm talking too much. We still have a lot of cards to go. I'll tend to skip over all of these. So, Make a Stand. It's cool. Mass awesomeness. Mass awesome buff stuff. Great. Limited. Cool. Like I said, I think it's funny that all the flying core are allies now, and they weren't before. No understanding why, but whatever. Mighty Leap, this is a reprint. It's an okay reprint. Actually, take that back. It's pretty great for this format. so that little guys can go past the giant Eldrazi, because most of them don't fly. Although I find it funny that none of them have reach. Like, not a lot of Eldrazi have reach. You think they would, because most of them are huge. Or a good amount of them are huge. Pardon. So, Munda's Vanguard. This is the white intro deck promo. So, we haven't seen deck lists for the intro decks yet. But I'm going to assume the white one has to do with allies. And this is also the first time that we're seeing Cohort, new mechanic. And the cost will always be the same. It's tap this dude and tap another ally. Put a +1/+1 counter on each creature you control. That effect will be different per cohort. But I enjoy this card. I don't know how big of a deal allies will be in the format now, in Limited. Well, no, allies are always a big deal. There's plenty of allies. There's plenty of ways to make allies. So, cohort's a pretty good mechanic. And all the effects are interesting. I'll be sure to evaluate them all. But this is probably one of the better cohort mechanics, because there is also the +1/+1 theme that within this set. It's a very mild theme, but it's there. Now, we have the first Oath. The Oath of Gideon. Which, if you guys haven't realized yet, he's one of my favorite planeswalkers, if not my favorite. Definitely tied for my favorite white planeswalker. I love Ajani. I also love Gideon. For totally different reasons. So anyways, Oath of Gideon, legendary enchantment. It's the first of a 4-card cycle, not including black, because Liliana decided not to come. When it enters play, 2/1/1 white core ally creature tokens, which totally supports not only, like, this is really good for Limited, just because of that first effect. It's a one-off, and then your opponent's not going to pay attention to the darn thing, and it'll just, the enchantment will stay there, but at least you got ally tokens out of it. And then each planeswalker you control enters the battlefield with an additional loyalty counter. This is being talked about because of Gideon, the planeswalker from Battle for Zendikar. Because as of now, Gideon, ally of Zendikar, when you ultimate minus him, actually that's the only minus. When you minus him for his ultimate, he just auto dies. But if you Oath and then go into Gideon, you get all those benefits. Actually, I might start... Oh, wow. I think I could build a mono-white deck for cheap. I think I'm going to do that. I'm going to try to build a mono-white deck for standard. Maybe. I don't know. Probably not going to work very well. It's probably going to still be expensive because Gideon is one of those stupid expensive cards. So this card is definitely good for Limited. It's not something that you should draft highly. But it's okay in Limited. Might see constructed play. And Super Friends are going to love it. Let's see. Undo War Cleric. Cohort. Gain 2 life. It's fine. It's fine. It's not that good. Although it is a bear. It's got bear stats. That's a bonus. Relief Captain. ETB, support 3, still has the downside of if there's nothing in play, us in play, this is bad. But depending on how you're, like, if you draft around allies and massing board, support's going to be good. Searing Light, destroy a target attacking or blocking creature with power 2 or less. Going through some of these cards, just up here, there are a lot of creatures that have toughness 2 or less, so it's gonna be good in Limited, or at least, yeah, it's gonna be good in Limited, or semi-good. Any kind of removal is good. It's not as good as Immolating Glare, of course, but it's fine. Constructed? I don't think so. Maybe, but I don't think so. Shoulder to shoulder, it's support two cantrip. This is fine, because worst case, well, no. The worst case scenario is terrible. Pay three to draw a card? That's so bad. But if you do get the support two out, that's actually pretty good. And I am just now realizing this is Tazri in the background right here, fighting with Gideon. That's really cool, actually. What's that, guys? Wow. So sorry. But, yeah, no, this card is okay. It's not the best. Now, I love the concept of this card. Spellbinder Mage? Okay, as a card, it's halfway decent. It's fine. It's common. It's okay. But the art and the effect, or in the flavor text, is one of my favorite combinations. Follow me, step lightly, and resist the urge to kick them. So essentially she's using, that's a hedron at the end of her chain that she's using to make a little force field around herself, kind of like a salt circle from Supernatural, to keep the Eldrazi from attacking. And resist the urge to kick them, because if you step out of the circle, you're dead. I love it. The card itself is good. The 4-drop 2-4 is okay. And, yeah, the 4-drop 2-4 is fine. Stats. And being able to tap down a creature is pretty good, too. But, I don't know, tapping two of your own guys to tap one of their guys, unless it's a really big guy, I'm not sure how big of a deal that is. Well, I don't know. Steep Glider. 5-drop 2-4. Huh. Flying Vigilance, which is both awesome. And then you can pay 2 to have target creature with a +1/+1 counter on it gain flying and vigilance until end of turn. That is fun! See, there is a bit of a +1/+1 strategy in this set, and I love it. It's very fun looking. And I can't wait to see, how much +1/+1 stuff was there in Battle for Zendikar? I don't think there was a lot, but considering that the draft format is 2 Oath and then 1 Battle for Zendikar, I could see the +1/+1 strategy being the stronger strategy versus some other strategies that are out there. So anyway, Stonehaven Outfitter, 2-drop 2-2, this is a rare right here. Equipped creatures you control get +1/+1. Whenever an equipped creature you control dies, draw a card. So essentially, it's making all equipments into Skullclamp? I can't remember the name. And this chick, I think it's a girl. She's only a buck. Like, the enchantment thing's not hitting the mark very well. This should be fun for Nahiri commander decks, or equipment heavy commander decks, and so's the card right next to her, Stoneforge Acolyte, who does ally cohort shenanigans to get equipment. The equipment will be later. In all honesty, the equipment strategy of this format is not that great. It's just something that exists. It's more like a sub format. You'd have to, I don't know, it's not that good. The last white card, Wall of Resurgence, when it enters play, I believe this is a reprint actually, I'd have to look it up. When it enters play, you may put 3+1/+1 counters on target land. If you do, that land becomes a 0/0 elemental creature with haste, that's still land. So essentially it brings you a 3/3 land, and that's a big ol' archetype in itself. I'm actually slowly starting to miss how Battle for Zendikar Limited was, how those drafts were. But, I don't know. We'll see what I like. Obtrusive Interference. Counter target spell unless the controller pays 1. And then you get a Scion. It's fine. It's cool. It's okay. Blinding drone, tap target creature, it's fine. Cultivator drone, add mana, it's meant for colorless, it's cool. Deep Fathom Skulker, here's another intro deck worker. So he's a 6-drop 4-4, which is generally bad, but essentially he's a Biden Athassa. So it's not bad for limited, it's pretty great. For standard, it's not going to happen. And Dimensional Infiltrator. It's essentially the not Stormcrow. Eldrazi. But it's still interesting. It's got Flash and Flying, and you can pay to exile opponent's top card. If it's a land, return Infiltrator to your hand. Which seems really bad, in my opinion, actually. I don't know how... That's not... Ugh. Yeah, I don't think it's good. Definitely not. I'd be surprised if it's more than $1. It's not even up here yet. Wait, no. There it is. $2? I think this card's being overhyped. I don't see the benefit of a possible unkillable thing. I don't know. I don't know what the hype is. Gravity Negator, pay, it has flying, and you can give something else flying, which is cool. Definitely good for limited. Prophet of Distortion, pay 4, draw a card. Drawing cards is awesome. But it's a 1-drop that you have to wait 3 turns at least for to be able to activate its ability. Or wait till turn 5 to gain Prophet. I don't know. It's okay for limited. Slip Through Space. Target creature can't block this turn. Draw a card. This is a great card. Especially for the Surge decks. Especially for the Surge decks. And especially for Eldrazi. You target a giant Eldrazi, have them attack, and just win. This is especially good if you somehow get Ulamog in your Battle for Zendikar draft. Or limited pile. Just a thought. Just throwing that thought out there, this is actually a pretty good common. Thought Harvester. 4-drop, 2-4 flying, that whenever you cast a colorless spell, target opponent exiles the top card of his or her library. This is a pretty good card for the ingest strategies. Ingest processor strategies. Again, I don't know how powerful that strategy will be since it's 2 Oath and 1 Battle for Zendikar pack. We'll have to see what happens. But stats are fine. 4-drop 4.3. 4-drop 2-4 is not terrible. Void Shatter. It is the Dissipate of Eldrazi. It's Eldrazi Dissipate. That's it. There's not much else to that. It's fine. Crab is a crab. It's a 3-drop, 1-5. It's fine. It's awesome. Play it. It's good for defense. Defense cards are great, especially for blue. That's all, really. Comparative Analysis is fine. It draws you cards. Surge. Very good for limited. I don't know if Constructed is available for this card. Probably not. Because the one instant that was the same cost as this draw two cards didn't see play. And I don't think Surge is going to make it see any more play than it will have. I think clicked the wrong one. Forget it. Containment Membrane. It's a Surge enchantment, which is interesting. Enchanted creature doesn't untap your... It's generally the blue ice your opponent, keep them from attacking mechanic. Or keep them from untapping mechanic. That they always have. This will be great in limited. This would be very good in limited. Play a 1-drop. Play Containment Membrane. Good. Or something like that. Crush of Tentacles. This is going to be an interesting one. I could see Control having this as one of their removals and then also getting an 8-8 Octopus. So it's not bad. It's a mythic, so let me see what the price is. As of this video, like $2. I don't think it's going to go up more than that. It's going to see fringe play, I think, at most, honestly. It's fine. It is very exciting, though. Like, this was the card that got everyone hyped about Surge as a mechanic. So props to the card for that. Cyclone Sire, when it dies, put 3 plus 1 counters on target land you control. If you do, the land becomes a blah 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 blah. So a 5-drop 3/4 that leaves behind a 3/3. That's not that bad, especially for limited. But no constructed play. See, this card. I love this card. Well, love and hate. I know it's actually kind of bad in regards to, in comparison to the other cards that exist that are very similar to this effect, it's bad. But it's also good for this limited devaluation because you got big giant Eldrazi to deal with, and then you also have little tiny dudes that you have that you can pump and change and pump and attack and go. And then there's a couple cards with monsters with prowess that this helps trigger. There's Surge, which is great to just play and then Surge something else. Overall, this is a pretty good card for limited. I don't think it's going to see constructed play. Maybe. Actually, it might. No, I don't think so. Because even when Rapid Hybridization was a card, it didn't see that much play. So next is Grip of the Royal. Tap target creature, tap down, draw a card. Good card, limited play, awesome. Continue. Now this is a card I need to talk about. This card right here. This is definitely one needing to be talked about. It's probably a buck rare, but I don't care. It needs to be talked about. I am correct, it's a buck rare. But it has hexproof for an enchantment, which I don't think that happens very often. But it's very cool. Beginning of your upkeep, okay, so have you ever heard of Yu-Gi-Oh? Have you ever played Yu-Gi-Oh? You know about Exodia, the forbidden one. It's like the first episode of Yu-Gi-Oh. The main character uses Exodia and then obliterates the opponent. Essentially, this is the Yu-Gi-Oh of Magic. Because the way Exodia works, you have to have all 5 pieces in your hand, and then you win, and there's only, like, 1 of each piece. In this case, you have to have 4 copies of this thing, and have 1 in each zone, each visible zone, and then your hand. And you win! I feel like I need to build this deck, because it's definitely possible. Like, the Exodia decks are all possible. They wouldn't print this unless it was somehow fun and possible to be able to do this shenanigans. I would say it would be similar to the Exodia decks. The Exodia decks, the general strategy is drawing cards and preventing damage. And then also using various effects that draw you cards for special recommendations. So, kind of like a fog control deck, but with another win condition with this. But the difficult part, no, semi-difficult part is getting one to the exile. But that's not that hard, honestly. Especially with in Standard currently, Delve is still a thing. And Dig Through Time is going to be awesome, would see play in this deck if this deck even ends up existing in Standard. So, you dig through time, you exile a Hedron Alignment that's in there for some reason. Either you discarded and drew, or something. You know, it's just an interesting idea. I think it will be fun. I would totally build a deck like this if I could. But I think this is a fun card. And also it lets you scry. Avenger, Surge, Flyer, 4-drop, 5-drop 3/3, or 3-drop 3/3. Both, one option is horrible, another option is great. Next. Negate is back. Not much else to say. There are a lot of creatures, like, I mean, creatures, there's a lot of giant Eldrazi. There's a lot of annoying Eldrazi, and there's a lot of annoying creatures. This is probably the perfect counterspell to play, to put in this set for blue. Alright, now, the Oath of Jace, who really should be taking care of Ravnica right now. But according to the lore, he's going to be going to Innistrad after Zendikar is all over. So, I'm assuming once we go back to Ravnica again, it's going to be a shithole again. Because Jace has been gone so long. Anyways, when Jace enters battlefield, draw 3 cards and discard 2 cards, combo it with Hedron Alignment. I'm kidding. It's like the graceful charity of... Graceful Charity is a Yu-Gi-Oh card that's actually banned. Lets you draw 3 cards and discard 2 cards. I'm not going to get into the reasons why it's banned. But that's a really good effect. Especially for the blue deck. Like, the Planeswalker style decks are going to like this. The Super Friends are going to like this. Because they're obviously going to be playing Jace Vren's Prodigy, and Jace Vren's Prodigy wants things discarded into the graveyard so that it can transform and do shenanigans. And then the second one, Scry X, where X is the number of planeswalkers you control. I mean, it's pretty cool. It's pretty awesome. Overwhelming Denial. It denies you very overwhelmingly. Can't be countered and counter target spell. Now, it's either going to be a 4-drop counterspell, which can't be countered, which is essentially a worse, what am I thinking about? A differently costed counterflux from Return to Ravnica. And then the Surge cost makes it an actual counterspell that can't be countered, which is awesome. I do not know if it will ever see standard play. I guess it has a chance if a deck thinks that it's possible, but I honestly don't think so. Rolling Waters, return up to 2 card creatures your opponent controls through the hand, target player draws 2 cards. So, this, I think, is bad. In Limited, it's fine, but it's still a bad card. What's not a bad card is this overpowered piece of interesting. So, not only does it kill Seed Rhino, which is relevant, it can't be countered, it has flying and hexproof, and instants and sorcery spells you control cannot be countered, which is amazing! I love this thing so much. Just, it needs... I love it. I love it so much. I wish it was a dragon, but it's fine. It's a sphinx. It's a sphinx, and it's awesome. It's definitely going to see some amount of control play. It's at $3 right now. It's definitely going to see some amount of control play because it's just that good of a card. I think it will definitely see play post-rotation when Siege Rhino is gone and a few other annoying cards. Of course, dragons are going to be still kind of existing because Dragon Scepter here will still exist and Dragon Lord Slungar and Dragon Lord Ojitai will still be in the format. But the mana base isn't going to be as strong enough, so if there ends up being like 2-color control decks, it's probably going to end up being Sphinx and Ojitai or Sphinx and Slungar. Or if they are still able to be Esper somehow, it'll be all three. Sweep Away, it's fine. It returned 3 mana for returning a creature to its owner's hand or putting it on top of opponent's library. In Limited, all removal is good. But this will never see constructed. Guaranteed. Umara Entangler. It's got prowess. It's a 2-drop 2/1 with prowess. It's fine. It's great. It's actually going to be... Actually, this card's really good for the blue-red Surge archetype for Limited. I do not think it's going to see constructed play unless some interesting deck arises. Because right now, in a Jeskai Prowess-type strategy, it's outclassed by... I am so bad with names today. The two-drop 2/2 white monk that has prowess and then you gain lifelink. That one. That card. That card's much better. Unity of Purpose. 4-drop, support 2, which is pretty good. And then you tap each creature you control with +1/+1 counter. This is great for the +1/+1 counter strategy. But I think the best part about this card is the flavor text is faced with the novel problem of inspiring an army. Jace asked himself, what would Gideon say? They're like best friends now. I love it. The jock and the nerd. That's essentially what they are. Gideon's a jock. Jace is a nerd. But now they're adults and they do adult things. I really should be going faster. I've probably been here an hour. Anyways, Bearer of Silence. Now, this card is interesting. The Void, when you cast it, you can pay one in colorless to have your opponent sacrifice a creature, which is great. I do not think it deserves to be $5. I don't know where people are thinking of putting this. Wait, no. Right, wait, nope, take that back. Almost forgot. Eldrazi Aggro. This card will probably be used quite a bit in Eldrazi Aggro. Even as just being a 2-drop 2/1 that can't be blocked, that has also flying. That's somewhat redundant. Isn't it? Flying and can't be blocked? I don't know. To me, it's redundant. But it's going to be good in the Eldrazi aggro strategy that actually becomes a thing. I hope it does, because that will be a very interesting deck to watch play. Dread Defiler. This is the other Eldrazi intro deck promo. That's for the black intro deck. And it lets you... It's a 7-drop 6/8, which is not bad. And you can exile... Pay 4, exile... creature card from your graveyard. Opponent loses life equal to the exile card's power. This kind of reminds me of many a Yu-Gi-Oh card that are able to just inflict damage and kill your opponent off. Essentially, that's what this card is meant to do. For Limited, this is amazing, but I don't think it will ever see constructed. Essence Depleter. Pay 2, target opponent loses 1 life and you gain 1 life. Huh, it's kind of funny that this, will work in the white-black life gain and drain strategy. Limited, great. Constructed, no. Flaying Tendrils is actually something that's probably going to see constructed play. Essentially, this is Drown in Sorrow. Version 2. All creatures get -2/-2 until end of turn. If a creature would die this turn, exile it instead, which is great. This is just a good card for control to have more help to get rid of aggro. This will definitely see standard play. This is pretty good and limited. Play it always. Havoc Sour, 4-drop, 3/3. Can pay 2 to have it get +2/+1 until end of turn. It's okay. It's probably pretty good and limited. Not constructed. Now here's an exciting one. Inverter of Truth. It's a mythic. 4-drop. Got Devoid, Flying, Inners, Battle. Actually, first off, it's a 4-drop 6/6. Now, 4-drop 6/6 generally have a history of being standard playable. And, wow, why am I this far down the list? And according to my calculations, a $9 hype probably means everyone else is thinking that it's playable as well. When enters the battlefield, you exile all cards from your library face down, then shuffle all cards from your graveyard into your library. That's actually kind of a major downside. It's not when it's cast, it's when it enters battlefield, so it doesn't have, you can't just cheat into play and not activate the effect. So I assume the best time to play this card would be super late game. But I'm wondering what deck is even going to be using this, to be honest. I guess I should look at what everyone else is thinking about it. Because, in all honesty, I'm drawing a blank as to where it's going to be sitting in Standard. The downside is relatively minimal, especially in aggressive decks where you don't need many more turns to win. Yeah, that's essentially what everyone's thinking, on the internet at least. It's for aggressive decks, you play it early enough, you'll kill your opponent fast enough. But I think that's going to not work very well. But we'll see. We'll see what happens. I bid everyone trying it good luck. Kozilek Shrieker gets +1/+0 and menace till end of turn. It's fine. Limited coolness. Translator, pay a life, add mana to your mana pool. It's decent stats, actually. But not constructed, just limited. Oblivion Strike. I think this is an interesting one. Definitely a good limited card. Pay 3 to exile target creature. Sorry, 4. You pay 4 to exile target creature. Limited for sure. I don't know if it will see constructed. I don't think so. Well, actually, wait. Maybe? When rotation happens? Or maybe not, because I don't think anyone's using, I already forgot its name. Two colorless, one white, one black, exile target permanent, or non-land permanent, from Khanza Tarkir. That's going to be rotating out, and I think that's used semi-frequently, but I don't think it's used heavily enough for it needing a replacement. Next is Reaver Drone. This is being talked about for the Eldrazi aggro decks. You lose a life unless you control another colorless creature, which if it's an Eldrazi aggro deck, you're almost always going to be controlling another colorless creature. Which is great. Shifter of Skulls, Devoid. When another non-token creature dies, put a 1/1 colorless Eldrazi Scion creature token onto the battlefield. I really need this card. This is probably one of the cards I'm most excited about since I've been playing Commander more than anything. This card will be exceptionally good in my Commander deck, because it's all about having my things continuously die and come back. And then build up mana, and then do all sorts of other shenanigans. Very excited about it. Most excited. Standard? Maybe. There might be some interesting deck out there. Limited? Oh, for sure. This is going to be great in Limited. Sky Scour. Devoid Flying. When you cast a colorless spell, it gets +1/+0 till end of turn. This is fine for limited if you're focusing on the colorless strategy. I'm not sure about constructed for it. Maybe the aggro decks. Slaughter Drone, gains death touch, bear. It's overall good. Not much else to say. Unnatural Endurance. Target creature gets +2/+0 until end of turn, regenerate it. That's pretty dope. It's a one drop. I like it. For limited. Actually, with that cost, it could see constructed play in a aggro strategy. Yeah. I could see it. Well, that's only if aggro, like a black aggro deck or the the Eldrazi colorless aggro deck does become a thing, this will see play. Maybe. But limited for sure. Visions of Brutality, another enchantment. Enchanted creature can't block, and whenever enchanted creature deals damage, its controller loses that much life. That's pretty brutal. That's pretty harsh, actually. Instead of it being target creature, this creature not being able to attack, it's when it attacks, there's a major downside. Essentially, in limited, this would best be used to attach onto something huge. So long as you're not losing. And it's whenever it deals damage, it's not whenever it deals damage to a player. It's whenever it deals damage in general. So you can put something this onto some big Eldrazi that doesn't have trample, and then block it with tiny guys, and the opponent will still get that damage dealt to it. That's pretty cool. I like it. Not a bad card. Definitely play this in limited. Now, here's one of my favorite arts in the set. Witness the End. Ulamog and Kozilek just chilling. But its effect, target opponent exiles two cards from his or her hand and loses two life. It's not the most exciting thing in the world. It's not bad. But in draft, it's definitely not going to be picked highly. It's going to be one of those cards that kind of wheels itself. Unless someone's heavy into the ingest strategy, ingest processor strategy. But actually, you can't really figure that out that late in the game. Or that early in the game, in the draft. Anyways, continue. Corpse Churn. This is a card I'm also excited about for my commander deck. I'm going to try it. You put the top three cards in your library into the graveyard, and then return a creature card from graveyard to your hand. And that's pretty fun, especially if in my commander deck. Like, if I let my commander just die, I can get that back into my hand with this card. I can get a small creature that has a good ETB effect that I need immediately back into my hand. Like Internal Witness or any other card like that. Constructed? I would say yes if the If Sultai decks were still a thing, I would say this card might see play. But Sultai decks kind of died off. Actually, I haven't even thought about that for a while. Sultai decks really died off within the past couple months. So I honestly don't think this will see play right now. It might post-rotation because of Innistrad. Because who knows what Innistrad is going to be popping up with all of the dark shenanigans that set has. We'll see. Drana's Chosen. It's a cohort putting zombies that are tapped onto the battlefield. So this is actually a good one for using the effect end of turn. Just gaining more advantage on the board. It's pretty good. I'd say it's good for limited. Constructed, not so much. Grasp of Darkness, target creature gets -4/-4 till end of turn. For two black? Oh my god, this is great removal. Especially in this format. This may actually see Constructed play. I mean, it doesn't kill Siege Rhino. But once Siege Rhino rotates, it actually might be better. Languish is still a thing, but that's more of a board wipe. If you just need to get rid of one thing and not fear your stuff dying, this is probably a really good card. Yeah, I could see people using this in Standard. Essentially, it's a Bioblight from Theros block, but instead of it getting rid of a bunch of things, -3/-3, it's getting rid of one thing, -4/-4. Like, say you're going up against Kalidas, Trader of Get, you could get rid of that for this card. Yeah, I see it being a possibility. I wonder if it's priced yet. See if I'm accurate in my assumption that this may be talked about. Oh my god, this is a reprint. Okay. I actually didn't realize it was a reprint. It's actually used to be from Scars of Mirrodin, which that version is really cheap. And this version is really cheap. I mean, it's in common, I guess. The other version wasn't common. I guess I should look at how people are viewing this card before I make assumptions. Well, it's my assumption that I think it's going to be good. That it may see play. At least post-rotation. Because there will be more reasons to use it. Oh my god, I saw the best comment ever. Okay. So, this Eldrazi's wearing a sombrero. Is the first comment I saw on Mythic Spoiler. That's great. Tar Snare. Yeah. Everyone's actually pretty excited about this card. Yeah, I could say I think it will see play. So now to a card that'll definitely see play. This card's being talked about in Modern, Standard. It's going to be great and limited. This card's got its ticket to ride for sure. It's a 4-drop, 3-4, legendary creature vampire. It's Kalidus. Kalidus actually used to be a card from original Zendikar, or legendary creature. And he and Drauna are on two different sides. Drauna, when the Eldrazi showed up, Kalidus was like, succumb to the Eldrazi overlords. And now he wears an Eldrazi on his head. And, well, that is an Eldrazi on his head. That's just, it's sucking his brain out, probably. And then Drauna was like, I'm not doing that, and left. Love Drauna. But anyways, a 3-4 lifelink is great. If a non-token creature an opponent controls dies, instead exile it and put a 2-2 zombie creature token onto the battlefield. This, if in limited, this would be great for processor stuff. In standard, this is just great overall. Just exiling things. Exiling is always better than killing, most of the time. And then you can sacrifice a vampire or a zombie and put counters on him. This card is pretty fun. Could definitely see it being a commander as well. Malakir, Soothsayer, tap and tap, draw a card, lose a life. It's fine. I think its stats are a little... Well, I don't like its stats. It's... okay. No color. Pay 4, exile a creature card from your graveyard, put a zombie onto battlefield tapped. It's fine. I think it's okay for limited. I'm not a giant fan of it. It's meh. Remorseless Punishment. This card is probably one of the most hated cards in the set. Just because it... It's never a good idea to give your opponent choices. And these are all the choices. I mean, all these choices are bad for your opponent, but I don't think they're bad enough for the opponent to really care either which way. And you're spending 5 mana to do this. I don't know, it just seems bad. Now, here's something interesting. The next card. I'm done with Remorseless Punishment. It needs to not be talked about again. So, back here, Grasp of Darkness. Target creature gets -4/-4. 2 black. Tar Snare. Target creature gets -3/-2 till end of turn. Well, I guess, yeah, the rarity is different. Uncommon, it is better. And then common, this guy. Well, in limited, it's definitely great removal. Don't overlook it. But unlike the other one, this is probably not going to see constructed. is a little bit too much. There's better options in Constructed right now to get rid of creatures. Ruinous Pass being one of them. Not the exact same mana cost, but you know what I mean. So, I don't see this card seeing play. Untamed Hunger. Enchanted creature gets +2/+1, has menace. That's really good, actually. That actually reminds me a bit of a red enchantment from Return to Ravnica. No, not Return to Ravnica. It's either Return to Ravnica or Gatecrash. But that was always a good card for an aggro deck. And this is essentially the same thing, except it's -1 attack for one more mana, and also in black. It's not bad. I like it. I don't know if it will see Constructed play or not. It depends on the aggro decks and where they go. But Limited, for sure, it's pretty good for a common. Vampire Envoy, when it becomes tapped, you gain a life, and it's an ally. So this is like target numero uno. If you're using a cohort deck and you're in black, this is the card you need for and common. Otherwise, it's a 3-drop 1/4 flyer, which whenever you just go and attack, it gains a life. That's great. It's a good card. Zulaport Chain Mage. I want to be a Chain Mage. That seems like fun. And then you can tap and untap. Tap this, tap an ally. Target opponent loses to life, which is fun. Which is okay. Next. Oh my god, more modules for Eldrazi. Consuming Sinkhole. For 4, you either exile a land or deal 4 damage to a player. That's actually kind of bad. It's either a demolition or... not demolition. It's either a demolition, because I can't remember the name, or just a bad card. Okay. Eldrazi Aggressor. It has haste as long as you control another colorless creature. In Limited, this is fine. Well, as I should say, the Consuming Sinkhole isn't bad in Limited. Because of the deal 4 damage part. So it's better than Demolition. Or whatever the card is that I can't remember. Eldrazi Aggressor is fine in Limited. It's a tiny dude. So next we also have Eldrazi Obligator, which I'm so sad. It's like mind warping a Felidar and becoming an evil Felidar. And also, this is the card that's on the whale card. Not whale as in animal. Sorry, one sec. This one, the Warping Whale. It's the same guy. Does this guy have like a character arc or something? I don't know. Oh, too far. So yeah, now we know where this guy came from, and it's kind of sad, because it's like mind-effing a Felidar kitty, which are already probably endangered by now. It's so sad. Well, that's not what you're here for, I'm sorry. You're here to have me read the effect and give you my opinion. When you cast it, you can pay 1/2. If you do, gain control of a creature. Essentially, this is Zealous Conscriptors. It's mana cost plus this cost is the same as the Zealous Conscriptors from Innistrad. And that actually saw a lot of play. So I could see this seeing play as well. And it is... why do you keep scrolling down? It's a buck rare. Never mind. Not seeing play. Fringe play. It could see fringe play. And also, it is a 3-1 haster. So, maybe using the Eldrazi aggro decks? I don't think so. Maybe. Immobilizer Eldrazi. Each creature with toughness greater than its power can't block this turn. That's hilarious. How many cards have we gone by that have that clause? That have toughness greater than their power. There's this guy. There's this one. There's this one. There's quite a lot. There's quite a lot of creatures in this set that have toughness greater than their power, which is really, really funny. All right, so Kozilek's Return. This is probably one of the most hyped cards in this entire set. Like, no joke, and I'm also very hyped about this card. This is a very good card. I believe it's still going for around 15, 12. I don't know if you heard that. That means my headphones are dying. Yep, they're dying. Throw. I don't need sound anyway. But Kozilek's Return. Really good card. It's great early game for that first effect. And then for the Eldrazi decks, you put down your giant Eldrazi and you just deal a whole bunch of damage to everything on the board. And your Eldrazi lives. Because it's an Eldrazi. And actually, it's whenever you cast an Eldrazi. So it's not even when an Eldrazi enters play. It's when you cast it, then you play this. The Eldrazi you're casting doesn't even get damaged, I don't think. I think that's the way it's supposed to work. That's really exciting. This makes me want to build the Eldrazi decks, but those are also going to be stupid expensive. So, yeah, definitely look out for this card. Price-wise? I mean, if Eldrazi decks really become a thing, this will retain its value and maybe even go up a little bit. But there is potential that it will go down somewhat. But I don't think it's going to go... It's definitely not going to go under $5. I don't even think it's going to go under $10, to be honest. But it could. Ma Kozilek gets +2/-2 till end of turn. It's fine. It's okay in limited. It's great. Oh, and limited, Kozilek's Return. Oh, it's beautiful. You draft around this card. And actually, in draft, never pass this. Just take it. It's always good. And it's one of those cards that you don't want your opponents having either. It's not one of those types of things where you're taking it just because it's a good card and it's money. You're taking it so that your opponents never have it or use it against you. I love this name, Reality Hemorrhage. It's so good. It's hilarious. He's got a hemorrhage of reality. But it's a 2-drop instant, deal 2 to target creature or player. Oh, Lightning Strike, how I miss you. So yeah, instead of Lightning Strike, this is the new norm. They're continuing to not give us burn spells that are that big. So this is the new norm. This is how red aggro is going to be. We just have to accept our fate. Damn you, Devoid Hux, or Devoid Shock. Anyways, Akum, Flame Seeker. God damn it, this is annoying. There, it's off. Akum, Flame Seeker. 3-dropped, 3/2. Discard a card if you do, draw a card for cohort cost. It's fine. It's okay. It's not the best. If you're somehow trying to do the Hedron alignment strategy, it's great. Boulder Salvo, it's either a 5-drop 4 damage to target creature, which is bad, or it's a 2-drop 2-drop plus for 4 damage to target creature, which is also bad. Because there's already cards that exist that are around that mana cost that deal 4 damage to target creatures for other various reasons. So actually, this is overall bad for Constructed. It's not going to see Constructed play. Limited? It might. It probably will. There's a lot of targets that are 4 or under. Brute Strength is a reprint. It's back. +3/+1. Gain Trample until end of turn. It's nice. It's good. It exists. Now, I'm actually... There's two Planeswalkers in this set. Chandra Flamecaller and Nisa, which we'll get to. Nisa's the real overhyped one. And Chandra, like always, is deemed, well, it's not being deemed as bad like most Chandras are generally. But it's being deemed as, it's just being argued a lot. And I'm probably going to go to the Mythic spoiler and look up to what everyone's saying. The reason I'm not doing this for you guys while recording is because I don't want to show people's comments on my video. I think that's kind of an invasion of privacy. I mean, it is open for the public, but I don't think people expect their comments to be on a video. So I think it would be rude if I do so. So, like, the biggest arguments on each side, like, the proponent strong points of each side, the pro is that it's probably the second coming of the whole six-drop planeswalker are just bad. Because that's what they thought about Elspeth, Sun's champion from Theros block, Theros the set. That's what they thought about her when she came out. That Elspeth would be bad. But Elspeth ended up being the format-defining card. So some people are on the camp that that's going to happen to Chandra. That she may end up being a format-defining card at some point because her effects are generally quite good. The con is that her minus ability cannot kill Rhino right away. Even then, why would you do that? Why would you want to kill Rhino right away? Why would you play this with a Rhino in play? So I'm actually on the camp that this is a good card. Maybe not. It's not an amazing, I don't think it's an amazing Elspeth level card. I don't think it's Elspeth level at all. I think it could be a pillar in a deck though. Like Grixis Control is the first thing that comes to mind. Any kind of control deck that uses red would be great. Actually, that's generally just Grixis Control. But no, I think Chandra is good. And I definitely am not on the camp of people saying, oh, it's because it can't kill Rhino right away. Why would you play it with Rhino in play? That's a very bad idea. You kill the Rhino first. There's plenty of ways to kill Rhino in red. In black and blue if you're doing Grixis. So those are my thoughts on that. So Chandra, I like. And Chandra is probably my favorite red planeswalker. Purifying Fire being one of my favorite novels. Alright, next up, Ascender Helion. I actually think this is a reprint. I can't remember though. I could be very, very much wrong though. I am wrong. It's not a reprint. Huh. All Hellions look the same to me, effect-wise. But, 5-drop, 4-4, common, trample. Actually, that's pretty good for a common. Even just on its own without the other effect. And when it enters play, it deals 2 damage to target opponent. It's not terrible. I mean, it's good. It's decent and limited. It's not going to see constructed ever. But it's cool. Devour in Flames, and look, guys, spoiler warning for those reading the lore, this is probably one of the plot point cards that's spoiling the events of the storyline so far. I'm going into spoiler territory right now, please. When I get to the next card, it will be the end of the spoiler, but long story short, Chandra just arrived on Zendikar not too long ago. She hadn't run into her Planeswalker friends yet. And then right now, Obnixilus is beating Gideon and Jace's butt. But apparently, according to this card, Chandra is going to save the day, and I'm so excited. I need to collect all of the story cards. Anyways, spoiler over. The card itself is good. Additional cost, you return a land to your hand, which is not that bad of a cost to do. And then Devour Flames deals 5 damage to target creature or planeswalker. Now this kills a Siege Rhino, which is great. It's amazing. Goal. Ow. So, I think this is worth it. Like, if you're in the control type of strategy and you're playing this late game, dealing 5 to something, getting rid of it, that's great. And I think it's also great for aggro as well, to get rid of big threats on the board. So overall, great card. Chandra, represent. Kick that off Nyxilis's butt. Alright, Embodiment of Fury. This is one of 2 landfall creatures in the set, because landfall decided to have 2 more things. But, so the land creatures, you can, yes, trample. Land creatures have trample. Landfall, you get a 3/3 elemental creature as a land for a turn, which is great. With haste, so it can even be the same land that you just played, if you wanted. So it's a pretty good card. The landfall strategy is such a strong strategy in Battle for Zendikar, but I'm not 100% sure that it's going, well, in Sealed I think it's possible, depending on how many packs of Battle for Zendikar you get. I'm guessing 2. And I think that might be enough, because you could get enough landfall to have it be a good deck. Possible. Like, this is all up in the air as to what the province stats of you being able to do landfall with 2 Battle for Zendikar sets are. So it's not a bad card. And it might, even the landfall strategies might like this card. Who knows? Expedite. This is going to be great and limited for just being able to do surge costs. And also it's a cantrip. And also gives something haste. It does all of the things. What more do you want? It's great. It's all limited all the time. Now here's another spoiler. Chandra obliterates the Eldrazi because apparently she's broken. Why is she so powerful in the lore and her cards end up being argued about every single time? I don't get it. So, this card's interesting. This is probably one of the more interesting best surge cards in the set. So, it's either double X, well, actually, let me think about it this way. This is like Bonfire of the Damned. Actually, yeah, that's essentially it. It's Bonfire of the Damned. Actually, I have to look that up again real quick, because I forget if it's, Yeah, so Bonfire of the Damned is another one. It was the same cost as this, and also the Bonfire's Miracle cost is the same as the Surge cost on this. But the difference is Bonfire of the Damned dealt X damage to 1 target player in each creature he or she controls. So it's actually way more powerful. The Bonfire is way more powerful than Fall of the Titans, but Fall of the Titans is a lot more accessible. Because, you know, Miracle, you have to have it be the first card you draw on your turn, and then you can cost it for that. But Fall of the Titans is, like, you play Expedite, and then you can play this for its surge cost, which is great. I think this might see standard play. I'm not sure about Modern. I don't know enough about Modern to really know. But I think it's a pretty good card. And also, it has 2 of my favorite planeswalkers on it. Gideon right there, and Chandra right there. Incinerating Eldrazi. Spoiler. Anyways, Goblin, Dark Dwellers. This is being talked about somewhat. I don't think it's good enough. I don't think it's good enough for how hyped people seem to be about it. So it's got Menace, and when it enters play, you can cast a instant or sorcery card with converted mana cost 3 or less from your graveyard. Essentially, it's flashback on this goblin. This may be a foreshadowing for next set for Shadows of Innistrad for flashback coming back, which is a possibility. I don't think Snapcaster Mage is ever coming back. You can forget about that. Yeah, I don't think Snapcaster Mage is coming back. But Goblin Dark Dwellers, I do think it's a precursor to things to come. But as is, it's a good card for Limited. This is a great card for Limited, especially for the Surge decks. But for Standard, I don't think so. Well, actually, maybe. If this is the high curve of an aggro deck to let you get more of your burn spells back from the grave, I think that's fine. Goblin Forerunner, Goblin Surge, Menace. It's fine. It's okay. You play it and you have fun. Kazul's Toll Collector. But why isn't it a troll? That would have been the best. It's a toll collector. It's a troll. Damn it. So this is another one that has the equipment strategy on it, but I still don't think equipment strategies are good. But this card is interesting because it lets you attach equipment to you as a sorcery. But any equipment for zero cost. It's actually kind of fun. You know, if any good equipment comes out in Shadows over Innistrad, I could see this being a deck archetype. Just like a fun deck. Not like a big giant constructed deck. But just fun. We'll see. The Oath of Chandra! Oh my god, I love this card so much. Not its effect, really. I mean, its effect is great. When Oath of the Chandra enters the battlefield, you deal 3 damage to target creature and opponent controls, which is fine. It's essentially a, no, it's not anything. And then at the beginning of your end step, if a planeswalker entered the battlefield under your control this turn, it deals 2 damage to each opponent. Which is fine. It's actually probably the worst out of the oaths. But the flavor text is amazing. If it means that people can live in freedom, yeah, I'll keep watch. Because all the other oaths, everyone's being so serious that she's just like, yeah, whatever. Love it. Limited? It's probably not the best, actually. It's probably really, really bad on Limited. This will probably be one of those rares that cycled through the tables. Probably. Press into service. Here's your generic take control of your opponent's thing, or at least another one. And also it has support too, which essentially made it cost 1 or 2 more mana to support too. It's fine. Sets always need these kinds of cards. It's fine. Pyromancer's Assault, whenever you cast your second spell each turn, it deals 2 damage to target creature or player. At 4 mana? I don't think so. It's very... I don't think anyone's actually talking about this card for anything. Could be wrong. But I personally don't think it will see play outside of Limited, and even then, it's not actually that good for Limited, I don't think. It's good if you got, like, godly picks for all your surge stuff. Other than that, I'm not sure. Yeah, if you can have multiple out at once, interesting, but I don't think that's worth it. Yeah, no one thinks this is going to see play. I can agree with that. We'll see what Innistrad does, though. Maybe Innistrad will make this card more interesting, but I highly doubt that. Jeez, everyone wants my attention today. Reckless Bushwhackers, actually kind of fun. You can surge when it surged into play, all your creatures get +1/+0 and gain haste, which is pretty fun for aggro. And aggro does play a lot of low-cost dudes, low-cost things. So this wouldn't be difficult to be able to surge out. I could see this becoming a thing. I could see this being used in decks right now, actually. We'll see what happens with it. Sparkmage's Gambit deals 1 damage to kids. This card is okay. This card is good in limited. In limited only. If you're going in for the kill and your opponent has like one giant Eldrazi or two giant Eldrazis in your way. Or two things that are annoying in your way. And you need to attack and kill them. Other than that, I don't think this card is good. You know, it would be good, actually. You use this card, make sure your opponent can't block anything, and then play Reckless Bushwhacker. And then you win, probably. Because you wouldn't do that unless you're winning. Or you're about to win. But not in Standard, no. This is bad for Constructed. Very good, somewhat good and limited. Tears of Valakut. Oh, poor Valakut is exploding! Ugh. Tears of Valakut can't be countered by spells or abilities. That's really awesome. But it deals 5 damage to target creature with flying. I mean, it's not that it's bad. It's actually very good in the current Standard. You know what? This is actually going to be pretty good for sideboards against Ojutai decks. And then, of course, the Esper Dragons are going to know this now. Because this is perfect for getting rid of Ojutai and Dragon Lord's Lungar. Wait, am I correct? Yes, Dragon Lord's Lungar. Yeah, this is pretty good. I enjoy it. As a sideboard option for red decks, it's definitely going to see Constructed play in one way, shape, or form in sideboards. At least until Dragons are gone. We'll see what happens after that. Tyrant of Valakut! The dragon that must be in every set. I love dragons. I love this dragon. Is this dragon good? Meh. It's a 7-drop 5-4, which is bad. Or a 5-drop 5-4, which is decent. It has flying, and if its surge cost was played, surge cost was paid, you deal 3 damage to target creature or player. I don't actually think this is good. It's just a dragon. Doing dragon things. Zana's Commando, tap, deal 1 damage to target opponent. This is like Goblin Sharpshooter, only worse. At least it has first strike. That doesn't even make any... No. This is bad. This is a bad card. But it's interesting and limited. No, it's still kind of weird. It's a 2-drop 2-1 with first strike. That's good. Its ability can kill Scion tokens and other stuff. But overall, I don't think it's good. The last of the Eldrazi stuff and Devoid stuff. Birthing Hulk. It comes out with 2 1/1 colorless Scion creature tokens, and then you can regenerate for 2. I was almost thinking about this card for my commander deck, but then I thought about it. I already have something that's better. In Battle for Zendikar, there was another card that was a 6-drop that brings out 3 1/1 Eldrazi Scion creature tokens. Of course, it doesn't regenerate itself, but in Commander, I don't really care. In Limited, this card is great. In Constructed, it's probably not going to see play. It's fine. Ruin in Their Wake. Oh, this is actually really cool artwork, because it shows... I think this is actually Ulamog and Kozilek. And the way they walk around, the way they distort the earth, is drastically different. Because Ulamog consumes and Kozilek distorts. It's very cool. But anyways, you can search your land for a basic land and reveal it. This card's actually worded kind of weirdly, but essentially, if you have a waste, you put it into the battlefield tapped. If you don't have a waste, you put it into your hand. Essentially. So, it's actually kind of interesting. Will it see play? I think post-rotation it might. Like, once the fetch lands are gone, and mana is a little harder to come by. And possibly wastes will be used more, because colorless will be more acceptable as a strategy, since fetch lands will be gone. I think, yeah, this will be used in, like, the Eldrazi ramp decks. Maybe now, but more than likely post-rotation. We shall see. Scion Summoner, 3-drop, 2-2, brings out a 1-1. Limited playable, great, not for constructed. Stalking Drone, a Debear, that can be a 3-4 for if you pay one. Which is fine, for limited. It's probably not constructed playable. Vile Redeemer, it's a Devoid Flash. When you cast him, you can pay one to put a Scion creature token onto the battlefield for each non-token creature that died under your control this turn. Which is pretty dope. This actually might be something I play in my commander deck as well. Because you cast it, well, it has to be cast. It's not an ETB thing. But I think that'll be fine in my deck because there's so many ways for me to get creatures back into my hand. But, I cast Vile Redeemer. If a bunch of things died, I put Scion creatures everywhere. I like it. I thoroughly enjoy this card. The artwork is grotesquely pretty, though. Worldbreaker. Now, this is another exciting Eldrazi that, considering it's in green, and green is the best for ramp, I'm assuming that people are thinking about playing it. $3. They're thinking about it. But it's a 7-drop, 5-7, which is pretty good stats. Oh my god, you know what I just noticed? That land in the background. I'm going to have to show you guys this. Alright, one sec. This has to be something I show you, rather than just tell you about. Because I'm actually sure that you guys noticed it already without me even saying anything. But it's the Hallowed Fountain! It's a more pointy Hallowed Fountain in the background. That's amazing. Is it the same guy? It's not the same guy. But I think that is it. That looks exactly like it. That's really cool, if they did that on purpose. Very cool. Alright, to the card itself. When you cast it, you can exile an artifact, enchantment, or land. So essentially, it is a giant Ecstatic Slime. A giant exiling Ecstatic Slime that actually has reach, which makes sense. And you can sack the land and pay 3 to return them from the graveyard to your hand. Okay, now that I have read him again, I mean, never people being so overhyped about this before. It's actually not that big of a deal. For all that he does, there's other things that do that. And then the giant Eldrazi decks probably actually don't care about what it's doing. And then for 3 more mana, you can bring out Ulamog, and that's kind of the whole point of the deck. So I don't know if this guy, I think, will be tried out, and if it's deemed to be underclassed by everything else, not going to see play. Probably going to end up being a buck rare overall. That's what I think. This is one of my favorite cards, oh my god! I always pick, like, a common or uncommon to collect everything of. This is probably going to be it, and it's actually kind of good for limited. So it's a 2-drop 3-1 that can be a 2-drop. Well, that can be a 4-2. with Trample. Pretty cool. I like it. Look at him playing with the frogs. All right. Bonds of Mortality. This is the other half of... I already forgot the name, and it's one of my favorite cards in this set. Fall of the Titans. Fall of the Titans and Bonds of Mortality are both two of... There's four Planeswalkers doing things. Two of them are in each card. It's essentially, if you were playing D&D, Chandra is the mage. No. Chandra's like the DPS mage. Actually, this is World of Warcraft. Chandra's the DPS mage. Gideon's the paladin. Aggro paladin. Tank. And then these two are supporting, where Nissa is guiding Gideon... guiding Jace. Jace and Nissa are setting a trap. Period. Done. But, you know, this card is actually not that great. It's actually really interesting. I could consider it being a sideboard option somewhere. But I don't know what deck would require this as a sideboard option. Because anything that has Hexproof and Indestructible... Well, I'm talking about Standard right now. Anything that has Hexproof, Indestructible, and Standard is generally too big to kill anyway. Unless it's a red-green deck that... Unless this is a red-green deck that is having a problem with Sphinx of the Last Word and can get rid of its Hexproof. Or if you're trying to follow the Titan Ulamog, you can get rid of Ulamog's indestructibleness. See, I think this would have been more thematic if Kozilek had Hexproof. I think that would have been interesting. I wonder if that was ever considered, and that's why this card is Hexproof and indestructible. That would be a great question to ask Maro. I'm guessing someone else already asked it by now. But, it's okay. And actually, I was thinking about it in Modern. I don't think it's going to see play. But, here's a concept. The Bant, or the Boggles. The Boggle enchantment strategy. Letting the Boggle lose Hexproof so that you can get... So you can kill it. If you're in green. That's one thing. It's really the only thing I can think about in Modern. But I don't think that's worthy enough. Canopy Gorger. It's a 6-drop, 6-5 worm. It's fine. You play it. It destroys your houses. But you're happy about it. That's what the flavor text is. They're happy that it's fighting. But it's destroying their houses. Elemental Uprising. Target land. Becomes a 4/4 creature with haste till end of turn. Still land. It must be blocked this turn if able. Which actually kind of sucks, because you don't want to lose your lands. But it also works quite well for any of the strategies that exist for lands. Do they not realize that I am in the middle of filming? I'll continue talking while I messaged these Nimrods. So, Embodiment of Insight, since the red one had Trample, and red does have Trample sometimes. Filming. Okay. So, considering the red one gave Trample, because Trample is... either secondary or triatary to red. Vigilance is secondary or triatary to green. So it makes sense. Essentially, this is the same thing as the red one. It's pretty fun for limited. See, the red one I could see being in standard. Because trample is fun. Vigilance is also a very good ability, though. So we could see play. Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. So let's see, Gladeheart Calvary. This is a. I'm actually thinking about this for my commander deck as well. It's a big thing. I like big things that I can get from the graveyard and do stuff. Support 6. I can put +1/+1 counters on up to 6 creatures, which my deck tends to swarm at a reasonable rate. And whenever a creature I control with a +1/+1 counter on it dies, which should be a lot of them because of this guy, I gain 2 life. Per creature, probably. I like it. It's the green intro deck card. Did I say what the red one was? I actually don't remember what the red one was. I'll go back up later. Or I'll click this. But, any hoot. Oh, wait, actually, it's the Tyrant, isn't it? It's the Tyrant of Alakut. Okay. The dragon. But I do enjoy this card. It's going to be tried out in my commander deck, and we'll see what happens. Standard? I don't think so. It's way too big of a mana cost to even be attempted. But it's cool for limited. Definitely play this in limited. It's a giant bomb. Harvester Troll! Yay, there's a troll. Why are you not at the tolls? Toll Troll. When you enter his play, you can sack a creature or a land. If you do, put 2+1/+1 counters on Harvester Golem. Sorry, Troll. I kind of wonder what the conversation's like about this card, because this is one of the ones that was revealed today after everything was said and done. Because, I mean, if you do meet the requirement, this can block. This is essentially a Siege Rhino. Well, I mean, not like Siege Rhino in Epic Nyx and being able to drain your opponent's life and you gain life. But stat-wise, it's a Rhino. Yeah, that's what I thought. Like, it's very good in limited. Always play this in limited, but constructed is not going to see play. Maybe people will think about it post-rotation, but I honestly don't think so. I think once Steve's Rhino and Abzan Charm are gone, Abzan decks will die off. Lead by example. Support 2. This is, it's fine. It's a fine. It's okay. It's an okay card. It's not amazing, but it's good. Loam Larva. Enters play, you can search your deck for land and put that card on top of your deck. I kind of don't like this for limited either, but it's got good stats for limited. It's a 2-drop 1/3 for limited, and it gets you a land guaranteed. It's good in the early game, but probably terrible in the... Sorry, it's a May ability. So in the late game, when you don't need any lands in limited, you can just play it, and it's fine. Alright, never mind. I like this card. Definitely good in limited, never in standard. Natural State. Destroy target artifact or enchantment with converted mana cost 3 or less. So, the fun thing about this card, all the enchantments I remember so far, most of the enchantments I remember so far are 3 or less. And actually, I have... Thankfully, Mythic Spoiler has organization. So all the ones that we've gone through so far, I mean, you're not able to target Hedron Alignment, so forget that. So there's only one enchantment we haven't gotten to, and it can't be targeted by this. Okay, there's 2 white enchantments that you're not able to target, which are Iona's Blessing and Isolation Zone. But all of the Oaths, the Bonds of Mortality, Pyromancer's Assault, you're not able to, Containment Membrane, and Untamed Hunger, you're able to get rid of those. So that's pretty good. And that's what, like, 1, 2, 3, 5, 10, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 out of 12, 1/3, You're not able to target one third of the enchantment pool that's out there. That's not bad. I like it. I like it a lot. For limited. I don't know if it will be good in standard. Probably not. Netcaster Spider. We're going to skip over this very quickly, but it has reach. It's a spider. It blocks the flyers. It's good. You play it, you'd be happy. But the card to talk about is the most expensive card in the set so far. Nissa, Voice of Zendikar. You're currently going for... And actually, you probably should reload my page. Oh yeah, the price has all changed since I last looked. Huh. 20. It did go down a little bit. It used to be 21. Oh wow, what the heck is Kozluck? There he is, okay. So, MTG Goldfist is having a problem with organization currently. But Nisa's currently going for 20. She's definitely the most hyped card in the set. I really think she's overhyped. A 3-drop Planeswalker, yeah, it's great. Most 3-drop Planeswalkers have been good. Starts with 3 loyalty, and considering the state of burn spells in recent times, that's actually generally safe. I'm talking constructive. If you get this in limited, you just play it. But constructed, it's definitely going to be played. I mean, that's why it's being so hyped. But I think people are overestimating it. Plus one's great. You get a 0/1 plant creature you can block. That's about it. -2, put a +1/+1 counter on each creature you control. This is definitely great for aggro and mid-range, which is where it's supposed to be. The -7 is fine. But overall, I really do think it's being overhyped. Its abilities are not as powerful as people think it will be. The incremental +1/+1 counter are awesome. Don't get me wrong. And she being able to protect herself is great. I don't know what is wrong with my head right now, because these abilities are all great. But something inside me is saying that this card is not as great as people are making it out to be. So I don't know, we'll see. Like, it is great, it's gonna fight with Gideon and Obnixilus for some reason. They're all gonna be frenemies in the same deck. They're gonna have fun. It's gonna be great. We'll see. Alright, Nisa's Judgment. Support 2 for 5, support 2, and each creature with a +1/+1 counter mercs a creature, which is awesome for limited. It's not for constructed. Continue. Oath of Nissa, and she's a Vulcan apparently. And this was being said to be one of the better oaths, which it is. When it enters battlefield, you look at the top 3 of your library. You may reveal a creature, land, or planeswalker. Put it into your hand, put the rest on the bottom of your library, which is pretty good. This will probably see commander play. I will probably use it in my commander deck. Because I do actually have a couple planeswalkers in my deck. But this will definitely see play in frenemies. Or like a frenemy planeswalker deck. And then you may spend mana as though it were mana of any color to cast planeswalker spells, which is pretty dope. But, you know, it's all you can really say. It's not... The first ability is really good and limited. Because it allows you to get some of your best cards out. Into your hand. Creature-wise. And land-wise. Other than that, it's, limited, it's okay. Standard, it may see play. Commander will definitely see play. Halls of Murasa. Return target creature or land card from a graveyard to its owner's hand. You gain 6 life. This is fine. It's okay. Limited only. Standard never. Saddleback Lajack, when it enters play, support 2. It's a 4-drop 3-1. Can't even boost itself if it's the only one in play, because support was designed to not do that. I don't know. I don't like it. I don't like it one bit. I mean, I like that it's a lizard. I love lizards. But I'm not a big fan of the card itself. Sea Guardian, on the other hand, is kind of fun. So he has reach, 4-drop, 3-4 reach. He dies. Put an XX elemental onto the battlefield, where X is the number of creature cards in your graveyard. Another one I'm going to try to use in my commander deck. And it's probably decent, probably pretty good in limited, especially the reach part. And yeah, leaving behind a token is always good. Alright, Sylvan Advocate. This was the Magic Shows spoiler card, and it's pretty good. What was Talarian's again? I forgot. But Talarian had an amazing video. Anyways, the Magic Shows, this is the Magic Shows card, and as long as you control 6 or more lands, it gets +2/+2, which means that it can block a rhino and live. Because I can't get rid of a rhino on its own, but this is still amazingly good for constructed. Like, it's good in the early games. It's a 2-drop 2-3. Then once you get to 6 land, which is really easy in any kind of green deck, you can just sit pretty with it. It's pretty good. I would definitely pick up copies of this card, because especially, actually, when Siege Rhino leaves, this is going to be a great card. And actually, right now, it is going for $4? $3, $4? It's not bad. Tajiru Pathwander, Vigilance Trample, that's 5-4 for 5. It's fine. Vines of the Recluse, target creature gets +1/+2 and reach, untap it. That's... Oh! It's a one mana spell for Surge, and for some reason you're doing Surge in green. So I guess it's good in that regard. Limited. It's not going to see Constructed play. Syndicate Resurgent. This is all the way a commander card. It's probably exclusively a commander card. I can't see this being played in standard. I can't see this being played too much in limited. Unless there's no way to cheat this into play in limited. But the art is really beautiful, though. That's the art on the game day playmat. Overall, it's a great card. Being able to tap land for mana of any color. Well, I mean, like, essentially, it turns all of your lands into the dual lands from the original Ravnica. Not the shock lands, the bounce lands from original Ravnica block. Well, except they produce 2 of one color instead of... Yeah, you know what I mean. It's great for Commander. Alright. And now we're getting into the multicolor and colorless that are not Eldrazi. Well, Monty, you get it. Flare Drone is another one that's probably going to be part of the Eldrazi aggro strategy. It's got First Strike 3-1 for 3, which is great. And whenever another colorless creature enters the battlefield, your target opponent loses 1 life, which is pretty dang good. I like it. Also good in limited. Mind Melter is also a 3-drop 2-2. It can't be blocked, which is always good. And for 4, your opponent exiles a card from his or her hand. But you can only do it as a sorcery. Which is fine. For limited, that actually is pretty good. I personally don't think it's good in standard. I could be wrong of people that are hyping it, probably overhyping it. Click. Jesus, I'm so sorry. So sorry for the sniffles and the sneezes. Yeah, it's not very exciting to most. It's fine. It's a fine magic card for limited. You play it, you love it. Void Grafter is also very good for limited. It's devoid, flash, enters battlefield. Target creature you control gains hexproof until end of turn. Which is really fun. Oh my god. I just am noticing the artwork of this card. He looks so serious. Like, there's this face right here. Just seems so menacing. Anyways. It's good. You play this. You love it. Eili, Eternal Pilgrim. The bitch. This girl, plot-wise, she almost killed Jace by feeding him to Ulamog. So, she's essentially a cult. She's in a cult. The card itself is great. Gonna be great in Commander. Gonna be great for the white-black life gain and drain strategy. Will it see constructed play? I'm not 100% sure. It might. But, I mean, a 2-drop 2-3, that's enough to, and with Death Touch, that might be enough to make it into, like, an Abzan aggro style deck. Who knows? Baelith Knoll, it's a okay magic card. I was thinking about this for my Commander deck, but I really actually don't need it. It's a 6-drop 4-5. In limited, I'm actually kind of not that excited for this as well, but it is a good card in limited. Being able to bring back or reuse your creatures is always good. Never overlook that. Now, probably the best, one of the best cards out of these uncommon dual colors is this guy, Cliffhaven Vampire. Whenever you, flying 2/4 for 4, whenever you gain life, each opponent loses 1 life, which then combos with everything else. And actually, let me just show you the one card I'm thinking about. There you are. Drowned Emissary. So, like, beginning of your upkeep, each opponent loses 1 life and you gain 1 life. And then, whenever you gain life, each opponent loses life. So essentially, if you somehow have both of these, which would be amazing, at the beginning of your upkeep, your opponent loses 2 and you gain 1. I love it. I love it so much. I mean, even, this might be the, I'm not sure if it will be a good budget deck, but I could see this being a fun budget deck to play. Jiraga Auxiliary, 3-drop 2-3. You pay 6 to support 2. Another card that's not good by itself, it has to have other things in play to be able to be good. Which essentially is the point of allies, is to have a big board of things and board of allies in play. But that's a really high mana cost for that activation ability. I don't know. I don't know if that's good enough. Jorian, Ruin Diver. So this is actually Allie. The Eternal Pilgrim also tried to kill Jorian, but she lured Jorian and Jace into a trap. But they escaped because Jace made everyone think they were on fire. Spoilers. So this is the Surge strategy card. If you get this in your limited pool, it would be a decent idea to try to do the Surge strategy. But overall, this is a good card. It's a 3-drop 2-3. That's already good stats. It lets you draw cards. Especially good late game. It's going to be great in Commander. It might actually be good in Standard. Maybe. I'm not going to 100% guarantee this will be Standard playable. But it seems like it could be. Especially when rotation happens and multicolored decks are not that much of a thing. It'll probably more be like two-color decks. Pardon. Alright, Mina and Den Wildborn. There's the lore story, the newest one, is actually about these two. You may play an additional land on each of your turns. So for those of you that were missing, Course of Reproof Fix, this does one of things Course of Reproof Fix did. So you may play an additional land on each of your turns, which is awesome. And for two red and green, return a land. Target creature gains trample. It's okay. It's definitely great in limited. Always play this in limited. I'm not sure if it's... Actually, wait, no. The Landfall decks might like this. They might like this, because it'll return a land. You can do more landfall things. It'll be fun. It'll be great. Maybe. It's a good card for decently. This is actually, wait, this is one of the best of the uncommon cycle for sure. Reflector Mage. 3/2/3, enters play, bounce the dude that your opponent controls. They can't play a card with the same name until their next turn. Or they can't play until your next turn, if it had a flash. That's pretty awesome. I believe it's being talked about in Standard. Definitely amazing in Limited. Always play this in Limited. And even if you're not in the colors, if there's not any... If you're drafting, and this is not in your colors, but there's nothing else better, take this away from the pool. You don't want to deal with it. That's what I recommend. Anyways, Relentless Hunter. Hunts relentlessly. If it's a 3/3/3, which is cool. And you can play 3 to make it a 3 to have it gain +1/+1 until end of turn. And trample. Making it a 4/4. Trample. It's actually pretty good. If you have nothing else to do and you're attacking and they block, you do this and you profit. Here's another amazing part of this uncommon cycle of cards. Flying Haste and Prowess, 1/3, 2/2. That's enough already. Like, this, in of itself, probably has created a new archetype that could possibly make it in Standard. This is definitely amazing and limited for the Surge decks. And actually, especially when rotation happens, I could see this being played more because Monastery Swift Spear will be gone. But, yeah, I can see this same play. I think will be fun. His hair is very weird, though. You notice that up there? Those, like, weird dreads standing on end? It's like horns. Anyways, here's Weapon Strainer. The last card of the equipment strategy before we get to the actual equipment. 2/3/2, which is fine. As long as other creatures you control get +1/+0, as long as you control an equipment. Doesn't even have to be equipped to anything. But, so it's cool for the equipment strategy. But this is if you're able to get any of the equipments. And let me show you, I'm just going to show you real quick the rarity division of the equipment. So, one common, this is not an equipment, this is a creature dude. Okay, so there's one common equipment, and it's Bonesaw. It's a great one, because it also is good for the Surge decks, so just have a free spell interplay. Uncommon, there's two uncommon equipment. Okay. And there's two rare equipment. So, so I don't know about you, but I'm not liking the probability of statistics of the equipments. So I'm not sure if the equipment strategy is as viable for sealed as it is for draft. Because, I mean, in draft, you're almost guaranteed to see a Bonesaw. So for some reason, if you open up with the Stonehaven, whatever, or the Weapon Trainer, if you, for some reason, want to go with that deck, you'll probably see Bonesaw. But, to be fair, the two rare equipments are actually pretty good. So Captain's Claws, which I actually love the art of. I want to make them. I want to make these claws so bad as a, like, a cosplay prop. Crypt Creature gets +1/+0. It's actually pretty cheap. It's a 2-drop, and then you equip for 1. And whenever it attacks, you essentially become... Actually, wait. Long story short, these claws make you Breemaz, or your creature Breemaz. Because whenever it attacks or blocks, a creature token comes out that also attacks or blocks. It is Breemaz. It's claws. I love it. It's really good for limited. Like, if you open this in a draft, I wouldn't... If there's nothing better, I would definitely take this. And if for some reason equipment strategy is open, I'd say go for it. So long as you get bone saws and stuff. Chitinous Cloak. Quick creature gets +2/+2 in menace. The mana cost of this is not fun. Other than that, it's okay. 3/3. I do like the art, though. Hedron Crawler. Look at it, it's so adorable! Everyone thinks this thing is so cute, and I agree. It's pretty cute. This needs to be a robot. It's a mana dork. It's a mana dork rock. It's literally a mana dork. It's adorkable. And that's pretty much it. It gives you mana. All of these cards that I've been mentioning are great for limited. I don't think any of these so far will see standard play, but the claws are tempting for me to try to make standard playable, but I don't think it is. Seer's Lantern. This one's been talked about. This was MTG Goldfish's preview card. And they're talking about their whole deal with the colorless mana thing. Is that, are you willing... Well, no. I mean, this is a mana rock. This has nothing to do with the lands. For control decks, this actually might... Or not control decks. Mid-range. Or any deck that is able to control its hand. Or wants to be able to control its hands. Is actually probably pretty good. Because not only... the card this is most related to only had a scry ability. You know, scry 2 for 1 in tap. Which is pretty good. But this having the additional option of being able to tap for mana is amazing. So it could definitely see play. Now, Stonework Masterwork is the other rare equipment. +1/+1 for each other creature you control that shares a creature type with it. Huh. I wonder what creature type in limited this could be referring to, allies. This is the really awesome ally equipment. This is why the whole strategy could even work. But also, this card is just good on its own in an ally deck. Or Eldrazi. Alright, the last equipment is Strider Harness. Equip creature gets +1/+1 and has haste. It's actually not that good. I'm actually not that big of a fan. Sure. Sorry about that, guys. Roommate. So yeah, the Strider Harness, it's, not that good in my opinion. In limited, it's fine. If you have it in your sealed pool, it's probably fine. But I could see this being one of those equipments that's wheeled as an uncommon until someone takes it for the equipment strategy. So anyways, there's a cycle of these lands, Cinder Barrens, that's an ETB for mana fixing. ETB tapped, mana fixing for allied colors. It's okay. The cycle is fine. It's fine for limited, but it's probably not so good standard. Actually, it's very bad standard. Corrupted Crossroads. This is an interesting one. So, this Corrupted Crossroads, essentially, it is a mana confluence for Devoid. And you can also just pay colorless. It's kind of odd. It's kind of weird. It may see play in Eldrazi aggro. Crumbling Vistage, another interesting card. Definitely good for limited. Yeah. That's all I really have to say about it. Now here's one out of three man lands. Hissing Quagmire. So, I may use this in my commander deck. I probably should. But essentially, it can become a 2/2 with Death Touch, which is not technically the best thing in the world. Rather, it would have been a 1/3 or a 1/4. Everyone wishes it was a 1/3 or a 1/4. But as it is now, it just trades with anything and dies, for the most part. Which is fine. Limited, definitely play this if you're in the colors. Standard? Maybe. Probably. And modern, probably. Just because it's black and green. Holdout Settlement. Tap it for colorless and tap an untapped creature. Add any mana of color to your mana pool. It's interesting. Definitely good for limited. I think I heard something about Popper this was good in. So, yeah. Props to this card. There's another part of the cycle. Now, here's our... I think this is the last mythic. Mirror Pool. So, this is a card that has an interesting issue. Now, I think price-wise, it's actually going for a decent amount. Yeah, $6. Still a decent amount. I think it's going to go down, actually. Because as it is now, in standard, I don't know where it would fit. I don't know if anyone really knows where it would fit. So, I mean, you have to sacrifice the darn thing. I think it might see play in other formats that find a way to abuse it. But you have to sack it to do either of those effects. Either copy a instant or sorcery or copy a token of a creature or copy a creature, put a token on. But the decks that have the most powerful spells and creatures to do that are so intensive with mana, like the different colors of mana, they shouldn't be sacrificing anything at any other lands for colorless because it will disrupt their whole curve. So, it's interesting. Interesting dilemma. And we'll see if it somehow works in any of the big decks currently. But we'll see what happens. We'll see if it sees play. I honestly don't think it will see play until rotation. And at that point, what's the biggest thing that you... Well, dragons. I don't know. We'll see. Needle Spires, another man land. It's a 4 for a 2/1 with double strike. No one was surprised that it got was a 2/1 with double strike, but the cost is a bit steep. Ruins of Oran Reef, which is an interesting card. Interest tapped, tap for mana, or you can tap it to put a +1/+1 counter on a colorless creature. Which is fine. Which is okay. Definitely good for limited, for the colorless strategies. Maybe it will see play in like a colorless aggro, or an Eldrazi aggro strategy. We'll see. I personally don't think so until post-rotation, but we'll see. Seagate Wreckage. This is the one I mentioned earlier. MTG Goldfish did their whole article about lands, the lands of this set. And what really struck out to me the most was what they mentioned about Seagate Wreckage. That where this could probably find a home most is in red aggro decks post-rotation. I mean, red aggro decks generally are green as well, and they shouldn't really try to afford space for a colorless mana producer that requires colorless mana to activate. But post-rotation... when mana is going to be a little bit harder to come by. I actually don't think I actually don't think Atarka Red will go away, because Atarka Red, the card, isn't going away this coming rotation. But mana is going to be a little less accessible. Like, Wooded Foothills is going to be gone. So it's possible that this card can be used in those decks, because they like to hellbent their hands. And they draw cards. So, it's a possibility. I enjoy the idea of that happening, but I don't know. And this is not an uncanny thing. Like, they were talking about in Modern how Desolate Lighthouse is used a lot for drawing cards and such. We'll see. I think it's a good assumption. There's the black one. There's the red-green one. There's the green-white one. Unknown Shores is back. Printed in Innistrad. No, incorrect. Printed in Theros. And essentially it was a carbon reprint of Transcaled Promenade, which then was a name reprint of Rupture Spire. You know, they could have probably just put Rupture Spires in here. It's the same thing. It's a good card for limited, good card overall. May or may not see play in standard, probably not. Now this is a card that's been talked about in Modern. Again, the same article I talked about. The big thing they mentioned that I didn't even know of is that there could be an elemental Modern strategy in blue-red, a combo, in which you just insta-kill your opponent. But the problem is, blue-red is the colors of the infamous Splinter Twin deck. Now, why would anyone in their right mind not use Splinter Twin if they're in blue-red? Essentially is the counter-argument for trying this out. So, it's interesting. It's an interesting conundrum. And also, it is kind of mana-intensive to try to get the combo off that, they were talking about. I think I'll leave a link in the description of that article so that you guys can read about it and know what I'm talking about. But it is a very interesting combo. It has to do with a particular elemental that gains attack every time something changes its attack and defense, which essentially Wandering Fumarole can do infinitely if it wanted to. So anyways. So the last land are the Wastes, which is just essentially, I'm going to look at the pretty artwork. Look at the pretty artwork. It's so nice. It's so pretty. Alright. That's it for the video. So now that I've gone over them, I want to pick a favorite card. Let me see. Well, I think one of the cards I'm most jazzed about, I don't know. I mean, I know I love Baileth Pop because of his adorableness, so that's probably my adorable pick of the set. Kozluck Return is good. It's a very cool card. I actually really enjoy Chandra. That might actually be one of my favorite cards of the set. I don't know. Oh, Devouring Flames. I do enjoy Devouring Flames. Probably not my favorite, though. Oath of Chandra's one of my favorites, for sure. I don't know. You guys would have to ask me another day if you really want to know what my favorite card is, and maybe I'll make a list. But I do love all of the artwork that's dedicated to the lore of Magic. I can't wait to put it all in order and see the story unfold. So anyways, we'll end the video with this beautiful image. Thank you guys so much for watching. This video was pretty long, almost like a 2-hour video type of deal. I did go over all the cards in this amount of time, which actually this is kind of normal for these types of videos, isn't it? For like card review type videos to go this long. So yeah, I have no regrets about that. So anyways, thank you guys so much for watching. Look out for the... Make sure to like this video if you like this type of content. Just like having me talk about Magic cards. Which is what I love to do anyway. Subscribe if you want to see more of these types of videos. Or subscribe if you want to get notified about when videos to pop up. And comment below. Tell me what you guys want to see. Now that I have my PC laptop, I'm going to be able to start streaming occasionally. And also start filming me playing Magic Duels and a couple other things. Dev Pro. It'll be fun. Alright, thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you guys have fun at your pre-release. Make sure to support your local stores. Go down, buy some cards, participate in pre-release, get your friends involved. Have fun. Alright. May the force be with you and such and doodly-doo.